name is Ruth Bramley. I worked at Sinclair Research from 1981 until 1984. And my job initially was technical advisor. That was my original job title. But I did various things along the way. I graduated in 1979 and with a maths degree. Spent some time looking for a job, eventually got a job as a programmer in Coventry. Somebody has to be. It was okay. But then met my husband-to-be and we decided to get married and to move to Cambridgeshire. So we started looking for jobs. And I wrote to all the computer-based companies that I could find in the Yellow Pages, because that's how you did it in those days, in the Cambridge area. Had lots of very helpful replies saying, sorry, nothing doing at the moment, but have you tried writing too? And lots of very helpful suggestions, having sent my handwritten CV and handwritten letter, or possibly typed, but that was it, to all these various places. And one of the people, one of the companies I'd written to, which I think they were called Cambridge Computer Cooperative or something like that, they were based in Bennett Street, I remember that. They wrote me a very helpful letter saying, thank you very much. Sorry, we don't actually have any jobs, but we do have a list of all the computer-based companies in the Cambridge area, which they sent me. And they said, we've indicated, based on your CV, any companies that we think might be possibly interesting for you and interesting as far as they're concerned for me. And so there was a long list, and one of the companies on the list, which hadn't been indicated as a possibility, was Sinclair Research. I should explain at this point that my maiden name was Sinclair, and I was very proud of the fact that my first calculator, which I still had at the time, was a Sinclair Oxford 300, bought with my Saturday job earnings when I was in sixth form, being the first year allowed to use calculators at A level.
Uh-huh. Do you remember how much it was?
I think it was about, it was a lot of money. I think it must have been about £20.
Yeah.
Which was a lot of money then.
Absolutely.
Because a Saturday job didn't pay very much. Saturday job in Marks and Spencer's didn't pay very much. But I very happily bought my Sinclair Oxford 300 and a power supply because it gobbled up batteries. So homework at home, plugged into the wall, no rechargeable batteries then. And it was great. So I thought, well, I'll write to Sinclair. So I wrote a very nice letter to Clive Sinclair saying I wondered if there might be any vacancies, and this is my CV, this is what I'm doing, and I'm hoping to move to Cambridgeshire to get married and this sort of thing. Had a very nice reply from Clive's secretary, Molly Pearson, who replied and said, really sorry, but there's nothing available at the moment. However, we will keep you on our books in case something comes up. And I thought, well, not a chance. Yeah. That's not going to happen. So then about 3 weeks later, I think, in the meantime, written to lots more companies and still nothing doing. And about 3 weeks later, I had another letter from Molly saying, please, would you give me a call? This is my direct line number, because Clive would like to meet you. Something has come up. So I thought, fine, okay. So I snuck out of the office at lunchtime, went down to the phone box because we didn't have mobile phones then.
No.
I couldn't really phone from the open plan office. And I called Molly and she said, yes, Clive wants to meet you. We've got something that's come up that we think might be, you might be the right person. Mm. I said, fine, that'll do. And she said, Clive's happy to see you at a weekend if that helps. And I said, well, I don't want to put him to any, this is Clive Sinclair. I said, I don't want to put him to any trouble. I'll, you know, I can come up, a Friday or Monday would be best because I can do a long weekend, but I don't really mind, you know, if it's midweek, so be it. And she said, well, how about Friday? And I said, yes, that was fine. So I took the Friday off work, got the train, because I didn't drive in those days, got the train up to over to Cambridge, which took some time from Coventry. And I went for this interview on the Friday. I do remember it snowed. And I was in my interview clothes and no coat and high heels. and it snowed. And had the interview. And at the end of the interview, Clive said to me, well, he said, it must have been, it was in late November, early December. He said, right, when can you start? I said, well, I have to give a month's notice. He said, fine, 1st of January then. So it must have been November or thereabouts. And I said, okay.
Straight
Isn't that a bank holiday? Well, the the first working day after the bank holiday, he said. Right. And that was it.
But there and then?
Job, there and then. Right. Yeah, didn't have to wait or anything. There it was. And then he said, by the way, he said, does paradise really exist? I lived in a place called Paradise in Coventry. And I said, yes, I live there. Is it? I said, not really. Somebody had a sick sense of humour. I remember that. Anyway,
so what was the interview like? Was it formal or kind of relaxed?
I really can't remember. I don't think it was particularly formal. I know I spent some time with Jim Westwood, mm-hmm. Who is still a friend, a very good friend. I met all the people at the Cambridge office. Now, there were a dozen of us.
Right.
That's it.
Uh-huh.
Very, very few people. Met everyone who was there, who was in at the time, and that was it, really. And I started in January. So this is the ZX80. When I had my interview with Clive, his leaving gesture to me was, here, have a ZX80 to play with. So I did. I had a lot of fun playing with my ZX80 on the television, mm-hmm. of course. And touch sensitive keyboard, which works by putting two contacts together. Mm-hmm. And of course, this was a very new thing, having keywords, so you didn't have to type out print to print or load for load. You had keys that would automatically do the keywords. So as you started programming, once you'd put your line number in, you then, as soon as you pressed the key that had a keyword on, so you know, if you wanted to print something, you'd press the P, no, the O key, which had the keyword print. So you do 10, print, just by pressing O, so you didn't have to type five letters, which was a bonus.
Yeah.
So a whole new thing. They had a reputation for getting rather warm because the heat sink, I think, was just under here. And there used to be a joke that you could fry an egg on it. I never tried it. That's the ZX80.
So what was the position that he was looking for?
We didn't really have job titles.
Right.
It was technical advisor,
right.
Which meant what I did is I dealt with all the questions and the queries from customers saying, it wasn't the I ordered mine 4 weeks ago, where is it? It wasn't that sort of, that was dealt with elsewhere.
Okay.
That was customer services. But what I dealt with was the, I would like my computer to do this. How can I get my ZX80? It was ZX80 in those days. How can I get my ZX80 to do this? Can you recommend a good cassette recorder?
Right.
That sort of thing. I can't get it to load. Can I run it from a car battery? That sort of thing. So it was going through all the different technical issues.
Yeah. Uh-huh. And requests from the public.
Yes,
so these are owners of ZX80s.
A lot of phone calls, a lot of letters.
Right.
Now, we didn't have email in those days, so everything was done by telephone or by letter.
Uh-huh.
So I typed a great many letters. A lot of letters. In fact, no, I didn't type them. I think I used to do handwritten letters, if I remember rightly.
Right.
We had typists who used to do those, type letters and things.
Fantastic.
Those were the days.
So you were featured in the very first Sinclair magazine.
I was, yes. On page.
Look at that.
How's that?
Double page spread.
Introducing the lady with more than her fair share of problems.
And those were the problems of other people.
The problems of other people, yes. And I was actually Ruth Bramley by then because I'd got married by then.
So it says in there that you were handling over 50 a day.
Yes.
Letters coming in asking for help and advice.
Letters and phone calls,
right.
Yes. Huge number. And I was the technical advisor.
So. And that was mostly about, or all about the ZX80?
That was the ZX81 by
ZX80.
Then.
Right, okay.
The ZX81 came out in April 1981.
Mm-hmm.
I started in January 1981.
Ah, right, okay.
So the ZX81 was already there.
Okay.
And,
so you had a bit of a steep learning curve then, really?
It was rather. It was a very steep learning curve generally. I think it was probably my first week there, maybe second week.
Mm-hmm.
And Clive came to me. I worked up in the lab, up in the attic of the office at in King's Parade. Right opposite King's College,
uh-huh.
and up in the attic, not looking out over King's College, Dave Chatton and Rick Dickinson had those rooms. I was at the back with sharing a room with Richard Alfasser. Uh-huh. And well, a room, it was a lab, really. And I remember Clive coming up to me on this morning and he said, I'd like you to go to London today. I said, okay, that's fine. What for? And he said, to go to the Design Council in Haymarket. I said, yes, that's fine. He said, just to set up the ZX80 with, no, I think it was the 16K Rampack. I can't really remember. It may have been the smaller Rampack, the 3K. Can't really remember. Long time ago. Or it may have just been the ZX80. It won an award, or been nominated for an award. Uh-huh. And so I got in the company taxi.
Company taxi?
Oh, we had a company taxi. Yes, we had a company taxi. And later a company aeroplane, which I can tell you about. But the company taxi, which came and picked me up not long after. I didn't have a lot of time to prepare. And I had my little portable black and white television and my ZX80, one of these, of course, and a cassette recorder, which I just hoped that would work, okay, because they didn't always. And and all the cables and things, and I got in the taxi and went down to the design council, uh-huh. in Haymarket anyway, remember that. And I had to pretend that I knew what I was talking about, bluff my way through it quite nicely.
Brilliant.
And people were asking all sorts of questions, and then, just to cap it all, this is one of the, because there's lots of press there, of course, uh-huh. and somebody from Capital Radio said, do you mind if we interview you? And I said, no, that's fine. It will go out this evening at 6 or whatever it was. And I was interviewed and tried to sound knowledgeable. Then afterwards, I had to find a phone box to phone my mum, who my mum and dad lived in London. Phone my mum and say, Mum, I'm going to be on the radio this evening. And she said it sounded very professional, so got away with it.
Great. Sure it did. Fantastic.
So, yes, that was the way, it was the sort of job that, yes, I knew what my job was going to be, but anything could happen.
Yeah, you know, it sounds a bit rough and tumble. You've got to roll with the punches.
It was so exciting. It was so very exciting. Uh-huh. In fact, I think it was in 1981, so within my first year there, I was asked to go and help with a training course. This was after the ZX81 was released, for WH Smith's staff, when Smiths were about to start selling the computers. Mm-hmm. I was asked to go and do a course, go and assist with a course, residential course, down in Oxfordshire. I think I had a couple of weeks' notice, maybe. And went down there. It was it August? I think it was August. And again, company taxi took me down there. Very nice. Abingdon, super place. Mm-hmm. Very nice residential place, training place. And I was there as the Sinclair representative. And it was great fun. I wasn't actually teaching, but I was there. They had somebody teaching the course.
Right.
And it was to groups of the senior WH Smith staff, who would then cascade it down to the shop floor.
Telling them how to use the computers.
Well, how to advise customers.
Right.
That's what it was, because they were about to start selling it. Everything had been done mail order up till then, and they were about to sell them in the shops, which was a big step, really.
It was a big step. It was not just for Sinclair. This was for computing full stop.
Well, yes, because suddenly in a high street shop, you could buy a computer. I mean, nowadays, we don't think about it.
You could
buy a mobile phone, which is far more powerful, probably in your local news agents. But... so I went down there for 3 weeks, if I remember rightly. Yeah. Was very well looked after, treated like a celebrity, which was very funny. But had a lot of fun there. And that was great.
Fantastic.
And then I think it was the following year, I was asked to do something similar for John Menzies up in Scotland.
Right.
Up in Edinburgh. I think it was a week in Glasgow and a week in Edinburgh. During Edinburgh Festival. How awful. Hardship.
Did you have any spare time to go and enjoy that?
I saw some very interesting shows at the Fringe. I did a lot of things on the Fringe in the evening, and was again made extremely welcome by John Menzies' staff and also the local Sinclair users fan club, who looked after me. Again, I was treated like a celebrity. It was very, very odd. Couldn't quite cope with that, but it was good. It was good fun. But that time I was actually teaching it, so I actually wrote the course. And went up there and taught the course to groups of about, I can't remember, 20 or so at a time, people, and taught. The course was a day or 2 days, I can't remember.
And what kind of level was that pitched at? I mean, is it?
It was for staff who shop staff who are going to be selling.
Right.
But I did it so they had more. It wasn't just a this is a computer, you plug it in here. I taught them through very basic programming.
Right.
So okay. We did do programming. It wasn't just a and this is the game, and it was nothing like that. We were actually programming.
Right.
I wish I still had the course. I'd written a proper course, a structured course that taught them through how you plug it in, through to writing, you know, quite interesting programs.
Wow.
In basic.
To W.H. Smith and John Menzies' staff?
Yes.
I'm not sure they listened.
They did then. they were all.
And you had to change the border colour.
They were all interested, which was very. It made my life a lot easier.
Yeah.
So that was good.
Well, it was a new thing.
They were there because they had to be, because their managers had told them they had to be. But they were there because they were interested, and this was new cutting edge stuff. And they were interested.
Brilliant.
So, yeah, good stuff.
Good stuff. So, back in the office, when you had all these questions coming in by phone or by letter or whatever, you know, what was? Did you have any really strange stuff, or is there anything that stands out from that?
I do remember one incidence of, I suppose nowadays you'd call it sexual discrimination.
Oh, right, okay.
I had a chap phone up on one occasion, and I was on my own in the office. Richard was out somewhere, and this chap phoned up, and he said, I'd like to speak to Clive Sinclair, please. I said, I'm terribly sorry. I said, can I help at all? Oh, no, I need to speak to one of the engineers. I need to speak to. I said, well, there's none of the engineers are here at the moment. None of the engineers being either Richard or Jim, the two engineers. I said, none of the engineers are here, but you know, I'm technical advisor. If you'd like to tell me what your query is, I'll see what I can do. No, I need to speak to one of the men. I said, well, I'm awfully sorry. If you just tell me what the question is. If I don't know the answer, I'll find out the answer and call you back. Or else I can ask one of them to call you.
Mm.
Oh, he went on. He wouldn't take no for an answer. And in the end, he said, I'm you're being very unhelpful, my dear. And I don't like that sort of tone. And I said, well, I'm awfully sorry, but you know, if you tell me the question, perhaps I can help.
Yeah.
And then he said, what's your name? I said, it's Ruth Sinclair, which it was at the time. And he paused. There was a wonderful pause. And then he said, well, I'm awfully sorry to have troubled you. I said, no, that's quite all right. No, I'm really very, very, very sorry. I said, well, look, if you'd just like to tell me what your question... Oh, no, I don't want to waste your time. I said, look, please, just tell me the question and I'll try and answer it. So he did. And it was... I can't even remember what it was. But
trivial, probably.
It was something quite trivial. Okay. And he said, well, thank you so much. I'm really, really, really sorry. Thank you very, very much. I said, it's fine. And Just let me say, next time, if a woman answers the phone, don't assume that she doesn't know anything.
Brilliant.
And that was it. I never had any problems after that. So I didn't hear from him again.
It's always those sort of situations where you get that kind of thing, and then it's this pathetic, trivial little question anyway.
Yes,
you just
yes.
Think, oh,
yeah.
Anybody can.
But having the surname Sinclair was quite useful. I did have another...
So did you chop and change when you felt it was useful?
No. This was before I was married. Well, so I didn't get married till the July in 1981. And... I did have another similar experience, well, not quite the same, similar experience, though, at an exhibition. I did a lot of exhibitions. I used to go down and do set up the stall, and in fact, the photograph that I sent you was taken at one of those computer exhibitions. And now, where were I? I think it was in London, fairly sure it was in London. It was quite a small computer exhibition. I think it was in Horticultural Hall, but I could be wrong there. And the chap who was organising it was very friendly, very, very friendly,
right.
Shall we say. And he kept coming and chatting to me. And he was, yeah, okay. Anyway, this went on for the two or three days of the exhibition. And at the end, when I was clearing up, he said, now, before you go, he said, can I just say, your father's a brilliant man. I said, yes. I said, yes, he is, yeah. I said, Clive isn't my father. Oh, he must be your uncle then. I said, no, we're not actually related. Oh, he said. The assumptions were made, especially because Clive had quite red hair, and I have. Assumptions were made, and not helped by the fact that Clive's father, Bill, said I looked very much like one of the aunties or something.
Yeah, right, okay.
But as far as I know, we're not related. So, that was quite amusing.
Yeah, great. Well, let's talk about the other people that were there as well.
Okay.
You've got a book there, Who's Who. Why have you got that? What's the Who's Who book about?
This was produced, I'm not quite sure when, there were three editions of it. This was the latest one before I left, which was in, I went on maternity leave in 1981. Mm-hmm. The first two, I should have brought those as well. The first two were much smaller volumes, which were, I think, just the Cambridge based staff. This one has sections of, so this has the Cambridge office, it has the, where are we? There's the London office, St Ives, Winchester. There was a small office at Winchester and Boston. Mm. That's Boston, America, not Boston, Lincolnshire. And we each had to have a photograph taken and write a little bit about ourselves. And this is Rick Dickinson, who I know you know, who's the designer. He designed the ZX81 and the 16K Rampack and the Spectrum, and their beautiful matte black format.
Absolutely.
Which became iconic.
Indeed.
And that was all Rick Dickinson's work. And I'm proud to say that I worked in the room just opposite. Rick's up in King's Parade, which is where this photograph was taken. And yes, I'm in there. I'll show you. I was very young. There we go.
Dinner. Fantastic.
That was actually taken not at King's Parade, but at the new office in Willis Road, which is off Mill Road in Cambridge, and is now part of Anglia Ruskin University. I think it's still called the Sinclair Building.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It had a wonderful glass atrium. Mm-hmm. And that was very high tech.
Wow.
It was a long way up from the office in King's Parade, where I first started. The whole of the Cambridge staff were based at King's Parade. There was also the office out at St Ives, which was in the mill, the well-known mill at St Ives, which is now, I think it's flats, I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. But it was a lab type, or labs in St Ives, massive building. Beautiful building. Anyway, King's Parade. It was by the Lunpolly Travel Agents and the Copper Kettle Restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
I remember that.
Copper Kettle was an important.
Absolutely,
name
as
in
was
Cambridge.
Lunpolly then. And there was a very insignificant looking door to enter this amazing place.
Uh-huh.
And I think behind the travel agents, right at the back, was the office where the reception staff, I don't know, there were three of them. There was a Jane and I can't remember their names. It's awful, isn't it? Too many years ago.
No, it's a long time ago.
Anyway, there were three staff who worked there in this back office. And then on the next floor up, we had Clive and Molly, his secretary. And there was Tony Rand. I'm fishing in the back of my memory here. Tony Rand and Jim Westwood, and Margaret, I think, who was Tony's secretary. Tony was the export director, manager, so he did all the export side of things. Of course, Jim was chief engineer, and Margaret was Tony's secretary. And then on the floor above, that was up in the attic, I think. There was Dave Chatton and Rick Dickinson. They had separate rooms, and in the front of the office, of facing King's College, and I was at the back, sharing a room with Richard Altfasser. And the photocopier was outside Molly's office, and it was very old, and it had a platen thing that moved, and it used to make smell. It smells of burning when you. Did more than 10 copies.
Right. Great. So what are the memorable people that were there in terms of their personalities? What was the atmosphere like anyway?
It was
your average work day.
It was great. I mean, it was very busy. Uh-huh. Everybody was very busy all the time. And yes, I mean, people worked very, very hard, but we had a lot of fun as well. And it was a nice atmosphere. It was a great place to work. Mm-hmm. It really was. And Clive was a great boss. He very much treated everybody equally, which became apparent later on when Christmas time, everybody received the same Christmas bonus. Mm-hmm. It didn't matter whether you were one of reception staff or whether you were chief engineer, you had the same Christmas bonus, which was quite generous. And I think in those days it was untaxed.
Right.
In those days. So everybody got the same. And Christmas hampers.
I've heard about the hampers.
Yes, the Christmas hampers. The first year, now was it? I think it must have been the first year I was there. I was stunned to come home from work shortly before Christmas to find a very large Fortnum & Mason hamper on the doorstep. When I say very large, it was, and I'm not exaggerating, it was a wicker basket about, by about that, full of Fortnum.
From the floor?
About that height.
Sort of 3 feet high.
I had the basket until fairly recently.
Wow.
There were two of them, actually, two consecutive years. Mm-hmm. Absolutely chock-a-block full of goodies from Fortnum & Mason and lots of polystyrene worms.
Right.
But it all well packed, and I actually still have a few of the things from that, from the hampers. Oh. One or two bits, not the edible things, obviously.
Yeah,
but all sorts of things. And it was so generous. It was such a nice gesture.
Absolutely.
Everybody in the company got that. Didn't matter what you did, if you were in the company.
In addition to your bonus.
Yes.
Fantastic.
And we didn't know it was going to happen. I didn't know it was going to happen. I came home from work and there's this basket. What's this?
Was this something that come from Clive?
Yes.
Or was it somebody else looking after the staff?
There wasn't anybody else to look after the staff. There was Clive.
Right.
So I guess it came from Clive, possibly organised by Molly. But it was from Clive.
It's from him. Yeah, that's lovely.
We didn't have an HR department. It was far too small a company for that. Mm-hmm. And there was another hamper the following year. And then a slightly smaller hamper the third year, but still very, very much appreciated.
Yeah.
And in fact, the last year, when I was actually on maternity leave, and in fact, I chose not to go back in the end because I liked being a mum at home. But I didn't think I'd get anything. I didn't expect to get anything, but I did. I had a hamper of champagne, was very nice and very, very, very welcome.
Yeah, absolutely. That's so really nice.
It was a very, very nice thing.
There's something, you've got the Who's Who book there,
yes,
which is very in style by the look of it with sort of the QL manual. And so there's everybody knows that Sinclair had a sort of a very keen aesthetic. He wanted everything to look nice and well presented.
Yes.
Same for the company itself.
Yes.
But then this also went through, it didn't just stop at the front door. This was something within Sinclair and the way that he treated his staff.
Produced just for staff. I don't think it was intended for outside world at all.
No, not at all.
But it was so that...
But it was still presented in a really nice way.
I mean, the modern day equivalent, I suppose, where I work, we have the intranet and we have our profiles. And the idea is you upload your profile picture and if you want, you can put a bit about yourself, what you do or your personal life. If you want, you don't have to. It's not compulsory. And I think it's the same sort of thing. So if I need to contact somebody at work,
it took a lot more effort then.
Yeah, I mean in those days you didn't have the internet.
And cost.
But this was done. Every member of staff had a copy of this, and because it's a ring binder format, so if there were new people, they could just produce a new sheet.
You could collect them
all.
And
you just put them in. Yeah, it was a bit like collecting your card. Oh, I will just show you this. I'd forgotten about this. I found it in a photo album. This was a Christmas card, and I can't remember if this was actually in one of the hampers. It may have been, I can't remember. And it's rather nice. Just the Sinclair logo and best wishes for a very happy Christmas from Clive, which I thought was rather nice.
It is. And that was in the hamper?
I think it was in the hamper. I'm not 100% sure. It's a long time ago. But I found it. I thought you might like to see it.
Yeah, definitely. That's really nice. So, yeah, we mentioned a couple of people in the Who's Who book. Is there anybody sort of memorable or a time specifically that stands out or an event?
Rick Dickinson, always great, really great fun, fantastic designer and good bloke. Jim Westwood, so helpful, such a clever man, and he's so helpful and so patient. I can never thank him enough for the amount of help he gave me when I first started. There I was. I'd worked as a programmer for just about a year. Mm-hmm. I was writing programs in COBOL, which is very different from BASIC. Yep. I learned BASIC at school, which was quite... Oh. Well, yes.
That's interesting.
the boys' school next door, I went to a girls' school, and the boys' school next door, which was part of the same school, but it was a separate school, if you see what I mean, had a maths society, and they had a computer. And this is where my love of computers really first... No, my love of computers started earlier. My first experience, proper experience of computers was in sixth form, and the boys' school had a maths society, which basically made use of their computer, which was about the size of a cupboard, a wardrobe.
Do you remember what it was?
It was a... I think it was a Hewlett-Packard, or it could have been a TI, Texas Instruments. I can't remember. I know it was wardrobe-sized.
Yeah.
And there was no screen, obviously. Mm-hmm. Everything was done on a teletype
machine.
So you typed and you had paper. Mm-hmm. And there was ticker tape, yes, real ticker tape. And they, anyway, they said that the girls who were doing maths A-level could go and join them on Wednesday lunchtimes in the computer room, and we could learn a bit of programming, which seemed like a good idea. Any excuse to go to the boys' school, quite honestly, was worth it. So doing maths was all right. And we did set up the inter-school computer dating system, which I think I might have been involved in.
Wow.
And I have to say my date stood me up. Anyway, there you go. So that was my introduction to programming, which which was in BASIC. I then went through university and did a maths degree and learnt ALGOL 60, which, again, it's a far cry from the computers of today. Mm. So very different. Mm. So we had to write programs, and they were done on cards, computer cards, which were about that sort of size, I suppose, and various different colours, and different colours signified different things to the people feeding the computer. Obviously, the computer didn't know. And there were punch cards, and we had to punch our own cards, and they were each card represented one line of program. And there was a room, the card typing room, which had quite a lot of card punching machines, but they were always busy because there were so many people doing either computing or computing as part of their degree that they were in high demand. But it was open 24/7, as we say these days. We didn't then. So the best time to go was actually about 2 o'clock in the morning. So once the beer had worn off just enough to be able to see which way to go, that was the place to go. And I spent many a long night, as far as I can, it seems like that now, typing punch cards. And then we had to bundle them up with a rubber band and put it in the in tray and then collect it. There were set times when you could go and collect your printout. That was computing in those days. So, yes, I joined Sinclair. That was my experience of computing.
Right.
BASIC at school, ALGOL 60, and then I worked as a programmer writing business software in COBOL for a small software house in Coventry, writing for people like Salvation Army and Permaglaze, the paint company.
Oh, wow.
And stock control, salary, that sort of side of things.
Because there were no standard packages back then.
We were writing bespoke software, really, in COBOL. Yeah. So that's what I was doing. And I was a programmer, so there'd be a systems analyst who would have come up with this is what we want the program to do, this is the structure. And then the programmers would write it. And I was just about to start training as a systems analyst when I left there to move to Sinclair. So I joined Sinclair with that background and didn't really... Clive gave me a ZX80 to play with over Christmas, which was good fun. But I'd never used anything like this because, well, it was very different. Very few people had unless you'd actually bought one. And Jim was so helpful, so supportive. So when I had questions that I didn't know the answer to, and there were plenty of those, Jim was always very, very patient. He'd sit down and he'd say, right, now let's go through this. And he'd talk it through. I can't tell you how. He would just put something across in layman's terms. So I understood it, and that was fine. And never patronising, ever patronising. Just really, really nice and helpful. So I can never thank him enough for that. That was good.
Fantastic.
So yes, Jim, great memories. Dave Chapman, who later became my boss for a while, or immediate line manager, as we'd say now, he was a great bloke, Welsh. And you could always tell when Wales had lost at rugby because he'd be fed up. And Clive himself, smashing chap, really nice chap, always very friendly. Well, in my experience.
Yeah.
I know he had a reputation as having a temper. I never saw it.
Right.
I can honestly say I never saw him lose his temper.
Never at all?
Never.
Well, that's interesting. Never. So, because we've spoken to quite a few people that have been involved in very different bits and about the way that Sir Clive...
There was never any temper directed at me. Anyway. Yeah. Certainly not.
Right.
So, yeah.
Interesting. So maybe that temper was sort of more directed at the people that were involved in the development things, where there was a time scale that was needed to be hit or a price point or whatever. Yeah. Hmm,
okay. No, I always had nothing but nice comments from Clive and praise, which is good.
Hmm.
Recognition of hard work, which is always good.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So I kind of did the most memorable people. Was there the most memorable experience at Sinclair?
Ooh, golly. Going down to the Barbican Centre to receive the Design Council Award, that mm-hmm. was a wonderful experience. Wonderful. In fact, Rick Dickinson gave me a lift down there in mm-hmm. his sports car.
Right.
I think it was an MG, but I could be wrong. it was very nice. And yes, we went down to the Design Council, to the Barbican Centre for the official presentation. And I don't quite know why I went, but I did. So there was Clive and Jim, I think, and Rick and myself. I think we were the only four,
mm-hmm.
and we had to set up was it the ZX80 or ZX81? I can't remember. Set that up anyway, and the Duke of Edinburgh was there, so I got to meet him, shook hands mm-hmm. with him. He was very pleasant. It was fine, and I seem to recall there was an extremely nice meal,
right?
And of course the presentation, which was magnificent, and it was the first time I'd been to the Barbican Centre as well, which was fairly new then, I suppose. Mm. Wonderful, amazing experience, really good. There were lots of exhibitions.
Uh-huh.
I did a lot of exhibitions. I did enjoy those a lot. Meeting members of the public, being there as the face of Sinclair. Later on, there was a department that actually did all that side of things. Mm. But we were such a small company at the time. No, who can do it? Oh, Ruth will do it. I didn't mind. I was quite happy to do it.
It sounds like at the time, because of the size of the company, and this is probably, it is typical of lots of small companies, but it was very much, you know, if you can do it, you did do it. Yeah, yes. Everybody yes. mucked yes. in, yeah?
I think one of the best things about Sinclair was, working at Sinclair, was that we didn't, although we had job titles, and they were mainly for the outside world.
Yeah.
So within the organisation, if something needed doing and you had the talent and ability to do it, then Clive was happy for you to do it. I was mm-hmm. fine. So I actually started proofreading when I was at Sinclair, and I think it was fairly early on. I proofread the ZX81 manual and the Spectrum manual and the QL manual, so consecutive years.
Mm-hmm.
I'd never done proofreading before, and I had a lot of help from a lady called Mary, who was a consultant, used to come in. She was brilliant. She taught me a lot about proofreading. And I am now actually a full-time proofreader. That's what I do now.
Great.
So, but that started my love of proofreading, being a serious pedant. I can tell you for full stops, italic, and shouldn't be. So that really started me on what I'm doing now, I suppose, 35 years later. But that was the first step towards that. Clive discovered I could do it. I discovered I could do it, and I liked doing it. So I didn't do a huge amount of it, but proofreading the computer manuals was where I started.
Right.
As part of my job, as part of doing the technical advisor, and later I became assistant production controller. I looked after archives. We had an archive section. I looked after all of that, all sorts of other things. So, yeah, it was very much, if you had a talent, if you could do something, and something needed doing, yeah. then fine, do it, take it on.
And this matter, went for everybody, you know,
yeah,
anybody
so.
Turned their hands.
I think so, yes. I don't think I was just the job's worth, the dog's body, rather.
Were you the only woman working there in a technical capacity?
Yes, I suppose I probably was.
Did you, obviously you knew it, but did it feel that you were
no.
at the time? Or you were just
no.
one of the team,
no,
it didn't make any difference?
One of the team. Yeah. My previous job as a programmer in Coventry, I was the first female programmer they'd had. So there were female staff, but they were all the typists. And the way we used to work writing programs, we had squared paper, mm-hmm. and pencils, and you wrote your program out, and it was one letter, one character per square.
Yeah.
It wasn't quite square, it was something like that. Anyway, one character per square. And you then sent your program, which was however many sheets it was, stapled together, over to the other office where it got typed, which was all a bit ridiculous because we were all perfectly capable of typing, but there you go. We had typists to do that. And when I got my job there, it never bothered me because I'd been at university in mixed, you know, men and women, it didn't make any difference. So in this job, I was the first female programmer. So there we were in the office, and I think there were about... I think eight male programmers and myself. I didn't have an issue with that, that was fine. And we worked fine, we worked together. This is in the middle of Coventry, near the station actually, in Coventry. And it was the days when you could smoke in the office, which I didn't, I'd given up at that stage. And so it was quite a smoky atmosphere, but you got used to that. It was normal then.
Yeah, absolutely.
I remember, they were very polite, these chaps, extremely polite, in a forced sort of way.
Right.
And the first 2 weeks I was there, there were several occasions when I'd hear them about, you know, someone would say, "Oh, bother," which is fine. I don't mind. I'm not fazed by the odd swear word. Doesn't bother me at all. But they obviously thought I might be offended.
Yeah.
And then one day I was writing something and made a mistake. Oh shit! And 8 pairs of eyes looked at me. I said, "Sorry." And I think it was the same day we went out for lunch, went to a pub for lunch for someone's birthday. And one of the chaps said, "Can I get you a drink?" I said, "Oh, that's very nice." I said, "You don't have to." No, let me get you a drink. I said, "Fine. Orange juice?" I said, "Well, am I allowed alcohol?" "Of course you are. Would you like a glass of wine?" I said, "Can I have a pint of Guinness, please?" "Guinness? Are you sure?" I said, "Yes, please. A pint. Yes, please." "Oh." So I sank my pint of Guinness, which was fine, very nice. The next day in the office, I was invited to play cards with them at lunchtime.
Ah.
I declined because I actually don't like playing cards, but that's fine. But they were, it was a whole different atmosphere. So I'd been used to having to stand my ground and say, "Look, okay, I'm a woman, but I can program, I can drink beer, and I can swear." So it didn't faze me at all. And in Sinclair's, there was never any of that, never at all.
Right.
Not even slightly.
Right.
You know, we were a team. We were such a small company. I shared a room with Richard Altvasser, who was an engineer and spread stuff. And I used to push his stuff back to fight for my little bit of bench space. It was a lab, really, rather than an office.
Yeah.
But I perched on a stool, I think. I don't think my back would cope with it now. But it was fine. Health and safety would have kittens.
yeah, they would now.
Yeah,
but that's just the way it was.
It's fine. It's fine. I survived.
Yeah. Great
I grew
stuff.
Up in a world when you didn't have seat belts in cars.
No, absolutely. Yeah, like you say, you could smoke in the workplace. And,
yeah.
So many machines we get in from various workplaces just coated in nicotine.
Yeah,
and
yeah, it's horrible. It was. Horrible. But it was the norm then.
Yeah, absolutely. So we kind of touched on it a little bit, but. We just go a little bit more into the work ethic at Sinclair.
Yes.
So it was kind of was it work hard, play hard? Or it, you know, tell us
definitely work hard, play hard.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Yes, the parties were quite something.
Uh-huh.
Parties at Clive's house. I have some very fond memories of some parties at Clive's house where the drink flowed very freely. And they were a lot of fun. There was a magnificent bonfire party, which I do remember very clearly. I believe that I can't remember his name, the man who does the fireworks who lives in Kimbolton.
Yeah.
The vicar.
Yep.
The mm-hmm. vicar. I think he did the fireworks and they were spectacular. I have a wonderful memory of a rocket. I've never seen anything like it before or since. This amazing, it was mortar really, I suppose. And they'd actually bored into the grass, into the garden. I don't know how deep this hole was. There was a tube in the ground and this rocket was down there. And so the whole ground shook when it went. It was fantastic, spectacular. It really was. But the whole thing was magnificent. There was so much generosity there.
Uh-huh.
And it was staff and staff and family,
right,
or staff and partners. We had amazing Christmas parties, but we all showed it back to Clive. So when it must have been his 40th birthday, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, must be, because he's seven. How old is he now? I don't know. Anyway, I think it might have been his 40th birthday, and they had a birthday cake made for him. And I think it was a surprise. I don't think he knew about it. It was a Spectrum birthday cake. I wish I had a photograph of it. It was fabulous. It was big cake, black icing. I'd never seen black icing before, but with the rainbow stripes. And it was a Spectrum keyboard cake, which was lovely. I do remember that. But he was such a generous chap. Mm-hmm. Yes, we did work very, very hard, but we knew how to have fun as well. There were a lot of great. The Christmas parties, which were... Where did we go? Went to Sweeney Todd's by... I'm fishing in the back of my memory here. Sweeney Todd's, which was down by the Mill Pond. Great pizza place.
Uh-huh.
Christmas dinner, why not?
Absolutely.
It was good. We had a lot of fun.
Yeah.
A great deal of fun.
Uh-huh.
As well as working hard. And I've made friends who... I'm still in contact with Jim Westwood.
Uh-huh.
And family.
Lovely.
Lovely.
It sounds like... I mean, obviously, this came down from Clive himself. He enjoyed a party.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. And it seemed, I've spoken to quite a lot of people that don't seem to be particularly related to the industry that said, oh, yeah, I went to one of Clive's parties once.
Yes.
How did you get in there?
Yeah.
What's going on here? Yeah.
The house was fantastic.
Yeah.
So. He lived in a place called the Stone House on Maddingley Road,
mm-hmm,
which was an amazing place. Very modern. Very, very modern inside.
Mm-hmm.
Super massive garden. Really good.
When we were speaking earlier, you were talking about how the documentation was produced.
Yes.
And the phrase copy and paste. It's not quite the same as it is today, is it?
Copy and paste, right. I actually spent some time with a printer when we were doing the... I can't remember if it's the ZX81 or the Spectrum manual, or possibly both, actually. Lee Grave Press, the company was called,
mm-hmm,
and because I proofread the manuals and spent some time with them, and that was quite relatively high tech. I think they were doing litho printing then. But earlier on, I'd done some work with Sinclair with another printer. I think that might have been the ZX81 book, which was cut. They had to do some cutting and pasting, and I remember being up in the studio with the artist who was putting this all together. And it was physically cutting and pasting. Cut and paste meant you had your printed text and you took a scalpel and you cut the text out and you had cow gum, I can still remember the smell of cow gum, and you placed it on the page. That was cut and paste. It's not control C, control V. No. Well, copy and paste. Or control X and control V. It wasn't that. It was physically cutting with a scalpel and using cow gum to place it on the page. Yeah. So
it seems so far removed, doesn't it?
It is.
Than what we have today.
Yes.
And bearing in mind that this is the computer industry.
Yes.
So this is the industry that has allowed us now to do control C, control V.
Yes.
Yeah, it was still producing its manuals by cutting out bits of paper. Very art-based, you know.
But once we got to Lee Grove Press stage, I learned a lot about printing and about... hot metal printing, and which I don't think they were doing. I think they were onto the electronic stuff by then. But the hot uppercase and lowercase. Do you know where it comes from? Would you like to know?
Yeah.
In the printing industry, this is in the days of when they used to have the individual letters and they place it on the frame that would then be used for printing.
Mm-hmm.
They had the letters in their individual letters in the boxes. And that you had the upper case, which was the capitals, and the lower case.
Well,
learned that.
Yeah.
So many things.
Brilliant.
No shift keys then. Well, keys on typewriters.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. Parties, hampers, the boat race.
The boat race. Yes, the boat race. Clive very generously decided that he would pay for all staff and... partners, I think. I don't think the children were allowed, but it was before I had children, so I don't know, to attend the boat race, because he felt quite rightly that Cambridge needed a bit of a support. So we we calmly got on the bus. He had this, he arranged a coach trip. We didn't sing songs, as far as I can remember, but we went down to London. He had booked the top floor of a pub by the Thames. I really can't remember what the pub was, but it was amazing. We had food. Oh my goodness, we had food. There was a buffet laid out. It could have fed far more than there were of us. Right. Top floor of this hotel with a balcony or gallery, big gallery, uh-huh. So as many of us as wanted could go out there. And they also had television screens, so you could watch it on the television inside, okay. If you didn't want to be outside. But you could see the race from mm-hmm. there. You could see, Barnes Bridge, the last one? Anyway, you could see the finishing line,
right.
And quite a lot before then. And we cheered. We did lots of cheering and plenty of eating and drinking. It was a wonderful... I mean, that was the sort of generosity. He had the money. Yes, he'd made a lot of money because of other people's hard work and because of his own hard work. Mm. But he was prepared to share that. It wasn't a keeping it all for himself. He was sharing it with his workforce, because without us, he wouldn't have been able to do it.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, so yes, the boat race.
Wonderful.
And I think Cambridge lost, but it doesn't really matter.
Irrelevant.
We were past caring.
Right. Okay. Page 2. Well, there's less questions here.
Fewer, please.
Fewer. Okay. Okay. Don't start that. At least you're not reading this. Right. You mentioned earlier the company taxi. Tell me more about the company aeroplane.
The company aeroplane. Right. Well, when Sinclair Computer Production moved up to Dundee, the Timex factory, it takes a long time, even in the company taxi, to drive up to Dundee. It's a very long way.
Yeah.
So I think I don't know whether Clive initially chartered an aeroplane or had a, but he actually had an aeroplane eventually. There was a Sinclair aero, in fact, there were two.
So when you said a Sinclair aero, was this a branded Sinclair aeroplane?
Yes.
And it was owned by Sinclair?
I do have a photo, I'll send you.
Oh, yeah.
It was owned by Sinclair Research. There were two. There was, the first one was a little Cessna,
mm-hmm.
and then the second one, later, was again a Cessna, but it was a prop jet, so
right.
Could go higher and faster. I should say at this point, I had never been in an aeroplane before,
right?
Ever, because we never went abroad for holidays, so I'd never been in an aeroplane. So it was a whole new experience for me the first time I went to Dundee, it was amazing. It was absolutely incredible. So the taxi picked me up from home. I lived out in the sticks, and it used to take me an hour to an hour and a half to get into Cambridge every day for work.
Wow.
By bus, and because I didn't drive then. And the company aeroplane would the company taxi would come and pick me up at about the time that I would, or a little bit earlier than I normally left to catch the bus. And take me to Cambridge Airport, little Marshall's Airport,
mm-hmm.
where we'd get on the, after the checks and everything, we'd get in the aeroplane. Now the aeroplane, I can't remember the first one, I did go on it once, but I can't really remember it. The second one certainly seated 5 passengers, I believe. There was a pilot and co-pilot,
mm-hmm.
and then there were four passenger seats, and there was a fifth one at the back, which was actually the toilet.
All right, okay.
It was a little curtain. No, nobody ever used it. Nobody ever used it. but it was also a seat. It's a commode, really.
Okay, yeah, it's lovely.
Yeah, great. But we'd there were tables so you could sit facing one another and work if you wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the aeroplane. It was tiny.
Wow.
And having been picked up from home about 7, I think, in the morning, I would be in Dundee, ready to work. So we used to have to be picked up by a taxi at the other end because mm-hmm. the factory was some way from Dundee Airport, and taken to the factory, and we'd be in the factory by 9:15-ish. So 2.5 hours after leaving home, I'd be in Dundee working.
Wow.
And yeah, company aeroplane. Great. Fantastic. And on the way home, well, the minibar was opened. Having had a huge lunch as well, still sitting there going, I've eaten too much.
There is a theme of food and drink coming out.
There was a lot of theme of food and drink, yes. Yeah.
So what were you doing in Dundee then? Why were you going up there?
By that stage, I was assistant production controller. Uh-huh. And so I was responsible for ordering the... not the components, but the complete units. So I was ordering based on, I had to order about 6 months ahead.
Yeah.
So I had to try and anticipate from trends how many computers would be, how many spectrums would be needed for 6 months' time. So that meant ordering the complete units, the spectrums, the 16K RAM packs. Oh, actually, no, we didn't have 16K RAM packs by then, but spectrums, no. Certainly. The cables, the polystyrene boxes, the cardboard outers, the two set. Right. There were two manuals came with the spectrum. Yeah. There was the, I haven't got them here. There was the spiral bound one, and there was also a slim one, yeah. Thin one, stapled one, mm-hmm. Which I heavily edited.
Yeah.
That was Clive said, can you do an edit job on this? Yeah, fine. So I did. Don't have my name on it, but I did.
Yeah.
And all those things. Great. So I had to order all the components. It wasn't the circuit boards and resistors. It wasn't
not at that level.
Complete units.
Yeah. So how did you know how many you're going to need to buy?
Had to guess. Looking at previous sales and working out how many we needed. It was all a bit of, you know.
But was this computer aided at all?
No. Computer aided? Is that a spectrum?
You had the machines there to do it.
I did use a spectrum for a business purpose, because at some point in my career at Sinclair, and I can't really quite remember exactly at what point it was, but we decided to do an analysis of the computers that were coming in for repair, mm-hmm. and what the faults were. We had a company who used to do most of our repairs in Cambridge. They were based at French's Mill. Mm-hmm. On Huntingdon Road, I think. Anyway, they were based there. I can't remember the name of the company, but they used to do most of our repairs.
Right.
And I used to get a report from them saying what the repairs were. So whether it was a faulty power supply, whether it was a faulty heat sink or a CPU rather, gone faulty or whatever.
Yeah.
And I'd have a report from them. So I had to do an analysis of how many were coming back, how many were being correctly or actually repaired or had to be replaced, what the faults were and all that. And I decided I was going to do the whole lot on my spectrum. Well, my spectrum, there were a number. And so I actually wrote a program to do it and printed out my weekly report using the ZX printer.
What else?
With its wonderful thermal paper. so I did. So I actually did use it for a business purpose.
Uh-huh. Great stuff.
Yes.
So you were there for about 4 years.
Yes.
So you did see sort of the development of the QL, probably not quite the launch? Or?
No, I can't remember when it was launched. I think it was just after I'd gone on maternity leave. But I did proofread the manual. That was...
How much has Sinclair changed from the point that you joined through to...
Huge amount. Huge amount. The ethos of the company was still the same.
Uh-huh.
The everybody is equal was still there.
Uh-huh.
It was a very, very much bigger company by then. When I first started, there were 12 people, I think, in the King's Parade office, about the same at St. Ives. There were two or three people in Boston. Nigel Searle was actually in Boston when I joined. He then came back to England.
Uh-huh.
He was based in Boston. And there was a lady called Leonie, and there was somebody else, I can't remember the name, in Boston. That was it, as far as I know.
Mm.
Oh, and there was the London office, which was basically Bill Sinclair, Sir Clive's father. Lovely chap. That was it.
Right.
By the time I left, I've no idea how many people there were, a lot more. The Cambridge office was at the Willis Road site. I have a photograph. You probably know it. There you go. Very prestigious it was.
Beautiful.
It had a lovely brushed stainless steel front, which looked dreadful when it had rained. It had an atrium and it had a roof garden.
Right.
splendid roof garden.
Very nice.
And the last year I was, I left to go on maternity leave, and I was told by my doctor I had to put my feet up at lunchtimes. So I spent several lunchtimes a week up on the roof garden when it was fine with my feet up in the sunshine, which, and it did. I had a good tan that year. But it was very nice. And we had a caretaker, a chap who used to go up and cut the lawn. Yes, there was a real lawn. It wasn't AstroTurf. He had a little Flymo type mower, and he'd go up there and cut the lawn. And we had flower beds. It was a proper roof garden.
Yeah, real garden.
Yeah, real garden up there, which was lovely. So, yes, by the time I moved there, I have no idea how many people were in the company then. There was one big office that had, it was office come lab, and I was there. I did have an office of my own for a while, but then we rearranged and I was in the lab, but mm-hmm. It was fine, it was no big deal, it was fine. Yeah, there were a lot of people, and we had marketing people then. Mm-hmm. Jane Boothroyd was in charge of marketing, I think. Mm-hmm.
But still a great place to work.
It was still a great place to work. And we still had
that's hard for a company to do, to go from that small size up to something big and with that many pressure.
And by that time, they actually introduced a canteen. We had a staff canteen, which was down on the ground floor, looked out over the car park. And we had a chef, a devoted chef who did all our cooking for us. Uh-huh. And he was very good. In fact, I met him about 2 years ago, quite out of the blue, and didn't recognise him, but he introduced himself. I remember you. He said, I used to cook for you.
Brilliant.
But, yeah. We were all in the canteen one Friday lunchtime, uh-huh. And the entrance to the Sinclair building, it's on the corner, it's on a sharp corner, or right-angled corner. And there was the gateway in. The gate was, it was magnificent. It was very much corporate image. Mm. There was, because the whole Sinclair logo thing was on the front of the building, and there was a glass gate. So when the office was closed, the glass gate would be closed. And it was just a glass gate, heavyweight glass, obviously, with the Sinclair logo etched onto it. And it was a sharp bend going into this car park. And on the corner, on the left-hand side, there was a fish pond. There was a low brick wall, that high, and a fish pond beneath the glass panel that went over. There was a glass panel over the fish pond.
Right.
Then there was a narrow post, and then the gate, mm-hmm. and then a panel on the other side. And we all thought, how soon before somebody hits that? No, we were told nobody was going to hit it. It was fine. It wasn't going to happen. I think it must have been about 6 weeks later. We were all in the canteen, which looked out over the entrance, in fact, ground floor, Friday, all in the queue, just gazing out. And I can't remember whether it was nice weather or what. We were all in the queue anyway.
Yeah.
And there was a car, took the corner a bit sharpish, edge of the glass, smash, glass everywhere.
No.
He couldn't deny he hadn't done it.
Not really, not with that many witnesses.
No, it was the architect. Anyway, when they put
sense
it
of
back,
irony there,
when it was replaced, they put a very large red pole down the side.
Oh,
the
that,
fish were okay.
None
of the fish were harmed, that's the important thing.
No, absolutely.
But it was very funny, you got a cheer.
So you have a big red pole there, that ruins the aesthetic.
Sinclair, it did rather, yes.
Sinclair hated that,
I think
that,
it was red.
Sure.
Anyway, they had to put a pole of some sort there. It was rather more obvious.
were there any people sending in items that they're designed peripherals or software. Things like that to the company? Did you get to see any of that sort of thing?
Yes, one of the things I did actually fairly early on in my career there was I used to... look at software that people had sent in and decide whether we would endorse it and actually publish it under mm-hmm. the Sinclair name. There were quite a few. I see you've got one out here. 1K ZX Chess. 1K?
I know.
I mean, 16K
impressive.
Wouldn't be even be the header on an email now, would
absolutely.
It?
Absolutely.
So, yes, 1K ZX Chess. And there were a lot of things that were sent in that were published separately. That's nothing to do with us.
Yeah.
absolutely fine. But we used to have people sending in games and other sorts of software, so possibly serious software, to be used on the ZX80, well, ZX81 probably, and Spectrum. And one part of my job was to actually look at these, to play games. And I don't like computer games, but I spent a lot of my working day playing computer games to check they work, trying to break them,
right.
And that sort of thing, which sounds awful trying to break them, but you know, to see where they were, that sort of thing. And then the cassette recorder would fail, wouldn't it? You know. So yes, a lot of that sort of thing. We had a lot,
right.
Which later moved on to the marketing department once they started doing that.
Right,
I initially
okay.
was doing that as well as the technical stuff.
So there was a, I think there was a couple of times, I'm not sure, where Sinclair, well, Sinclair himself, appeared on Tomorrow's World.
And, yes.
And were you involved?
I was.
You were?
I was, yes. I think it was I don't know if it was twice, certainly once they did it.
Right.
And they did, they wanted to try broadcasting a programme, a 1K programme, as a sound file. The idea was you plugged your cassette recorder into the socket on your television, mm-hmm. the earphone socket, I suppose it would have been.
Yeah.
Your 2.5mm jack. And you'd plug your cassette recorder in and record this program and then load it onto your Sinclair ZX81, which was really groundbreaking stuff. Mm. It really was. And I was charged with writing the program, which was something very silly. It said something like greetings from Tomorrow's World or something like that. I can't remember. I was charged with writing this and then going down there and working with Judith Han and all the presenters there. Lots of fun. Great fun. I went down there with Jim Westwood,
yeah.
I seem to recall.
Yeah,
very exciting stuff. And then, because it was recorded. I wasn't there. The recording was in the evening, I think. But I wasn't there for the actual recording, but I was there for the build-up to it, the working on it,
yeah.
project side.
Getting everything
ready, which
was
very, very
making
interesting.
It happen.
And then obviously watched it on
and
television.
You wrote the programme, great.
And I did, I did try it just to make sure it worked, and it did.
Yeah.
It was great.
Did you download it via the telly?
Yes,
you did?
I did, yes. How sad is that? I did, I actually downloaded it and just checked that it really did work, and it did. It was fantastic.
Great stuff. It's quite funny to see Sir Clive on TV. He was, regardless of what, and this has been told to me by somebody involved in that side of things, but regardless of what he was supposed to be doing, i.e. the BBC is impartial,
yeah,
you
yeah,
know,
yeah.
Ignored all of that.
Yeah, yeah.
As soon as he got his 5 seconds, it would be Sinclair computer, availability,
yeah.
And a bit of a salesman, regardless of what they told him he should or shouldn't
yes.
do.
Yes,
got to take it while it's there.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, come on, you know.
Absolutely, yeah, brilliant, brilliant. Yeah. So, did you get involved in writing any other code for Sinclair at the time?
Yes, I did. I did a photo shoot. This is a really interesting one, actually. One of the Sunday supplement magazines. I've probably still got it at home somewhere, but I haven't unearthed it. I didn't unearth it this morning. I think it was the Sunday Observer, but I could be wrong. The Sunday Supplement magazine, you know. They were running a thing on home computers. We were onto the Spectrum by then because
right.
it was colour, I remember mm-hmm. that. And what they wanted was a television. It was a fantastic idea. They had a fireplace with a television, a colour television set in the fireplace. Remember, television sets were not flat screen. They were.
No, absolutely.
They, you know, the
great big bulky things.
CRT things.
Yeah.
So there was a television in the fireplace, and they wanted a picture of a fire, so,
right.
you know, with flames and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea was they were going to have a dog and a cat on the hearth rug in front to try and indicate the home computer thing, the home
okay.
hearth and all that sort of thing,
mm-hmm.
and the computer in the hearth. So Muggins here got asked to do this. So I did actually write the program that did this picture of a flame and a fire and a flame and everything,
right.
you know, pixel by pixel,
because wow.
that's how you had to do
yeah,
it
yeah.
on the Spectrum, and spent a whole day down in a chapel, a disused chapel somewhere in London, company taxi again, and working with the photographers it was quite an experience. Brilliant. And the dog and the cat were fantastic. They were so well behaved, you know.
Right.
Yeah. Sit, lie down, go to sleep. And the cat did it as well.
Wow. But, was the spectrum that well behaved?
Behave. It was very good, yes. The cassette recorder worked, that was good.
So is this something you'd prepared for and you'd...
Yes.
You'd spent some time designing
but then
graphics.
They said, oh no, we didn't want it quite like that.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, fine. So I actually spent quite a lot of time programming there.
Right, okay.
On the job, as it were, which was quite fun. But it was a long day, I seem to recall.
Yeah,
but good fun.
Brilliant. And this was something that was set up by the magazine. It wasn't Clive...
No, we need a bit of promotion. This
was
about home computers, just Sinclair. But the photograph was a spectrum.
Mm-hmm. Great.
That's quite something.
Do you remember what your salary was when you started at Sinclair?
No, but I do still have my pay slips, so I can let you know.
It's interesting for people because it is so little in comparison. With today's money, although if you take into account inflation.
I think it was about 3,000, 2,000 or 3,000. I know that when I left, I was on about 11,500,
right.
Which then was a very good salary.
Yeah, absolutely.
It was a very good salary, and that was in 1984.
Yeah.
So.
But just 11,000, it's laughable.
It was a good salary.
At the time. Yeah.
Well, I'd moved from a job in Coventry where I think I was on about 1,500 maybe, I think, a year.
You do have to put that into context.
Yeah.
Per year.
Something like that. Uh-huh. Yeah, but then in context, our first house cost us 15,000.
Mm.
You know.
Yeah, absolutely.
Putting it in context.
Can you sum up for us, just so we've got it all rounded, you know, your overall memories and what it was like to work at Sinclair and how much you enjoyed it?
I had a wonderful time. It was four brilliant years of my life. They were four brilliant years of my life. It was a very good experience. I met some lovely people, made some friends. I thoroughly enjoyed the working experience. It was such an important thing. Mm. It was so cutting edge, very, very, very exciting. But still fun, you know, it was fun. Yes, we worked jolly hard, but we had fun. Well, I did. So, yes, I was very happy, never regretted it. It was a good move. Yep.
Brilliant, thank you. Great stuff. Well, thank you very much, indeed, for your time. Really appreciate it, it's been really interesting. Thank you very much.
Keep up the good work.